Today's very special guest, one of the top power forwards to ever lace up the blades, JAROME IGINLA, the greatest Calgary Flame of all time. Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show, Canada!
Oh, we are very excited about today's show. Our special guest was born in Edmonton, raised in St. Albert. Yes, we like him already. Longtime Flames captain, one of the best power forwards the game has ever seen. Two times he reached the 50-goal mark. He reached the 40-goal mark four times. 30 goals or more, 12 occasions, including 11 in a row. 1,554 NHL games over 22 seasons with the Flames, Penguins, Bruins, Avalanche and Kings, 625 goals, 1,300 points, a four-time All-Star. He won the Rocket Richard Trophy twice, the Art Ross Trophy, Lester B. Pearson Trophy, two Olympic gold medals. In 2021, last November, he was inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame. Ladies and gentlemen, Iggy, JAROME IGINLA. JAROME, welcome to the show.
Hey, Joe. Thanks for having me.
Well, you know, you're born in Edmonton, born in Edmonton, at the hospital in Edmonton, raised in St. Albert. Of course, I'm from Edmonton, too, just south of you. I live just off St. Albert Trail, as a matter of fact, in Dovercourt. We had some pretty good hockey teams, but none of us ever made it to the show. Tell us about your best, fondest memories of growing up in northern Alberta.
Yeah, I was born in Edmonton, and then I moved to my mom. I lived with my mom. My parents were divorced when I was very, very young. But my dad still lived in Edmonton. And I was very close with him. But, you know, he had a young family, and I grew up with my mom. And we moved to St. Albert from Edmonton at age seven. And it was a great move. My grandparents lived there. It was a wonderful community, a really, really good sport community. And my mom put me in with my grandparents, put me into as many sports as they could. You know, and it was a great community for that, from school sports to community sports, you name it, from hockey, baseball, bowling, basketball, volleyball, badminton. I played them all. My mom said I had so much energy, and she needed to keep me out of trouble. So very fortunate that that they did that.
Well, that's always a good way to get our energy out there, to expend our energy in a positive way. I just want to say that John and Brenda from the Dairy Queen, John and Brenda Power from the Dairy Queen in St. Albert, you're just so they said you were an amazing young fella. So I wanted to throw that in there. They're here. So I want to talk about your handle here, JAROME. Okay, so JAROME Arthur-Leigh Adekunle Teague Junior Elvis IGINLA. How did that name come about? Was there like you had to get all the grandparents or uncles in there? How'd that happen?
Yeah, it'd be better to ask my dad, but I've asked him before too. And the names are my dad immigrated from Nigeria when he was 17, 18. And so those names, JAROME, that's what, you know, him and my mom liked. My mom wanted it a little bit unique, so she put in an A instead of an E after the J. So it's, you know, JAROME that way. And then right. Arthur-Leigh was one of my dad's names when he was, is one of his names. And then Adekunle, that was my dad's name. And I don't quite pronounce her as well as he does, Adekunle. And it was his name in Nigeria. And when he moved here, he thought it was too hard to pronounce, and it would have been an issue. So he changed it to Elvis. And as you see my name, JAROME Arthur-Leigh Adekunle. Well, Tej Tejani was my grandfather's name in Nigeria. So that's where that one comes from. And I'm a junior. And we said Elvis, that's right. My dad's new name. When he came over and switched his name, and IGINLA. So that was a combination. It was pretty wild. I kind of, people always growing up, they would never believe me I had those many names. And But actually now, moving to BC, on my birth certificate, I have all those names. I can't, my actual legal name right now is Arthur-Leigh, because Jerome is fourth in line on that. And they won't, no matter what, this just happened a few months ago. I got to go in and get it changed. It's Arthur-Leigh, Adekunle Iginla. And I'm like, I tried to argue with them, but if it's fourth in line, you cannot do it. It has to be in the first three or something like that on your birth certificate. So it was a mess, but it's been fun and I've enjoyed having those names. And now I got to go stand in line and get it officially changed.
You know, I know exactly what you're going through. I was a junior too. I was Clarence Joseph. And so on my driver's license, I'm Clarence. And on my passport, I'm Joseph. And it's very confusing. And my last name is Tillipaw, and I go by Tilly. So I have all these aliases as well. So I kind of know what that business is all about. So tell us about any challenges that you had growing up in terms of your sporting career.
Well, I don't know if I, yeah, there was challenges and it was just, you know, I had an amazing, childhood and, you know, it was, you know, lots of love. And like I say, I grew up with my mom, but I spent a ton of time at my grandparents, but my dad was, you know, my dad had a new young family as I got older and my oldest younger brother is 6 years younger. And then I have two brothers and two sisters with my dad's side. So, and they still lived in Edmonton. So it was awesome. I just felt like, you know, people were always happy to see me, and my grandparents were, I spent a lot of time there after school, but you know, sport wise, getting into the sports, I was fortunate to make the younger teams as a first year. So it was usually working 2 year blocks. So baseball and hockey were my two favorite sports. And, when I made, the hockey team, say Adam, I started hockey at seven. I'll go back. I started hockey at age seven, and I wasn't very good. I was the bottom player, you know, in the bottom league, a novice. And it was just fun. I just went out and just enjoyed it, played, practiced right down the street from my grandparents. There was in Brayside, there was an outdoor rink. So I would go there after school pretty much daily and started getting better. Next year, I made the next league up. And it was Novice B. So it went Novice C, Novice B, Novice A. There was no rep teams. And then, so it was another good step, and I got better. And by the third year, they changed the ages. So you had 3 years of the one league. By age nine, I was now in the Novice A, and I was pretty good on my team. So I started to catch the older kids, and I mean, the kids that started earlier. But age 10 was rep team. So then I tried out. I made it, and I was the only underage to make it. And that was a good year. It was fun. I got to play with the older kids. But the hard year, to answer your question, was 12. 12 was first year again, Pee-wee. Second year, Adam, I was a second year. It was fun. I was the only returning player. But Pee-wee, again, I made it as a first year. And I was the only first year to make it again. And it was a little bit hard. It was kids coming into their teens. You know, you're, you know, 12 and 13-year-olds together. I was the only underage. So, you know, like, as far as being a rookie and you know, when you're younger, nobody really cared about ages, but by 13, they start to, you know, try to have the rookie veteran thing. And it wasn't as fun of a year. And also it was a year where it got a little bit more serious and I wasn't getting a chance to play as much. So it was a challenging year. It wasn't as fun. It was still fun. It is hockey. But it, you know, it was like where you're missing the odd shift or you're not on the power play anymore and things like that. It's not your turn up. So it was one of those years. It was a hard year. It was a good learning thing. My mom had to talk to me about teenagers and, you know, it was a little bit more, challenging on and off the ice. But the next year at 13, it was awesome. It was, you know, I was a veteran again, and I appreciated hockey more than ever. I got to play a ton. I know it's funny talking about veterans and rookies when you're 12 and 13 mm-hmm. years old. It could be an issue, but, you know, it is. And now I coach, the break off there, I coach now 13 and 14-year-olds, which is this bantam. And I can see some of the same, you know, locker room stuff and teenagers learning to be good teammates and you know, accept one another and have good attitudes and different, you know, ice time's not always the same in different spots of the game. So I see what they're going through, and it brings me back to when I was right around that age for sure.
So you're 12 years old, you're struggling a bit, you're not getting the ice time you want. What motivated you to stay with it that you could sort of pass on to those kids you coach today that are 13 and 14 years old and, you know, wondering if maybe they should give it up or?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's, you know, my mom, my dad, my grandparents are very, very positive. There's lots of the ups and downs are good for you in hockey, and it doesn't feel like that at the time. And you know, sports, and it's one of those things to stay positive, to keep working, you know, to look for the silver linings. All those, some of those are like cliches, but they really do. They do matter, and they do help you. And you know, some days are tough days, and you know, sometimes you need to. Get away from hockey too. Sometimes as kids and even an NHL player, is you think about it all the time. You think about your sport all the time. How can I? And all you really, you know, it's you want to make sure you're still enjoying it, but also with a growth mindset. You know, like at 12 years old, it wasn't about how good I could be at 12 years old. It was about trying to work to get better and enjoy the sport. So, you know, I spend a lot of time at the outdoor rinks. I spend a lot of time shooting balls, shooting pucks, trying to get better And I think the biggest thing is sure, there were kids that grew. It's kind of an age where also I left that out. It's a big starts a puberty, right? So as a teenager, mm-hmm. starting sports can all of a sudden it was hitting, and you're going against some really big kids. And I wasn't very big. I was a late grower. I was small, so it was intimidating too. But you know, and there were kids that were better than me, and that was fine. But it was just more focusing on myself and trying to enjoy what I did, but also just working to get better and not worrying that I wasn't the best today, and just trying to get better as my own self and player. And I think that is having that growth mindset and finding ways that I can look at my game and see, yeah, I'm improving. But most of all, finding ways to enjoy that work and enjoy the game.
Well, you found that motivation, you found the drive, and then you were eventually drafted by the Kamloops Blazers. And that turned into a pretty good situation for you. Tell us about, you know, what you learned in Kamloops, and because I think that's where you made that transition to a pretty good offensive player to a, you know, really good power forward.
Yeah, you actually reminded me, too. One of the, I was thinking of things when you asked about challenges growing up. And one was the WHL draft, getting drafted and getting to Kamloops. I was 14 years old, and that's when the draft was, and I got these letters. You'd get letters in the mail, and it's still very similar now from the WHL teams, and they would say, you know, we're interested in you. You know, we think you may be able to play with us. Are you interested in us? And it was very exciting to get those in the mail, and at 14 was the draft for me, and I had a bunch of, I had probably maybe 10 letters from different teams, and I had even a phone call. I even talked to one scout that said, you know, we think you have a possibility, you know, there's a possibility you can play here at 16. So I was really, really excited. And I played with the St. Albert AAA Bantam Sabres, and had some other friends on the team that were young and going through the draft too. And I got way more letters than them. And, you know, some of them had two, some of them didn't get any. And it was exciting. And the draft came that day, and I was actually one of the leading scorers as a rookie. And I was, to be honest, I was just wondering where I was going to get drafted, and, you know, very excited about it. And the draft came, and I didn't get drafted, and guys on my team did. And, it was devastating. It really was. And it was a little bit embarrassing. It was, cause I expected it. I had these letters, you talk with your friends, you wonder which one might pick you. And then you wonder what's going on, like what's wrong. So that was hard. It was hard. And I remember writing in my, wish I had it. It was my journal, and writing, you know, one day, you know, I'm going to make it, and I'm going to work hard, and it's going to look back. And I don't know, you know, I wish I could find that and read it, but it was one of the harder days. That was probably actually my hardest day in sports when you were asking, and I couldn't believe I forgot it. So thanks for bringing that up. But, it wasn't long after I got drafted to, not drafted, I got listed by Kamloops and it was the best thing for me. And I got to go there, and it was an amazing organization with a lot of great players and history and a really good culture that helped me learn and grow. So it ended up being for the best, but it was really hard. And it was something that I guess looking back, you know, made me tougher. But also looking back, and I was talking about growing, is I was small. I wasn't a big player. I asked our assistant GM and the GM of the Kamloops Blazers later, and NHL scout, Stu McGregor. But he was a GM there later in Kamloops. And I asked him, and he said I wasn't, and I asked Bob Brown, because it did bother me. I wondered why, like what happened? And they said I was just small, and it was, you know, it was, that was, must have been the reason. Maybe I had a bad tournament near the end. I'm not sure, but it ended up being good for me, but it wasn't easy to go through, that's for sure.
So Jerome, you make it to Kamloops. What happened in Kamloops that allowed you to become the type of player that you became?
Going to Kamloops was great for me. It was an amazing organization. And also for minor hockey to pro, it's a great step. It's semi-pro, you have way more fans. It's more serious. That takes that from minor hockey should be fun, and it is fun. And for me growing up, I hated taking penalties. I literally cried on my first penalty I took in novice, you know? So, I never really liked hitting. I didn't really like that. But when I went to Kamloops, I worked with Don Hay there, who was the head coach, and, you know, preparing me to, now you start to, he's helped me try to develop a role and preparing me to try to get to the NHL and what type of player I could be. So he wanted me to, he helped me develop into a power forward. I also had Shane Doan there as an older, a veteran. He was only a year older, but he was a power forward and someone I looked up to, and Don Hay was working with him too and developing that. So he worked a lot with us together to, hitting, get lower on our hits, how to finish checks, be a little bit more aggressive. Like I say, so my first year there, I got more penalties than I normally did, because then when I was looking at what a power forward was, I would look at guys in the NHL like Brendan Shanahan, Keith Kachuk. I would try to find guys but they had like so many penalties. You know, Shanahan like had 200 penalty minutes a year, so that wasn't quite there. But I took more, I never wanted to take tripping and those type of penalties. So, I guess a power forward is, you're thinking they're like roughings together, or sometimes it's fighting, or at the end of the game when the game's out of line in junior, you're trying to get your penalty minutes up. It would be like at the end of the game, you get into some pushing and shoving matches or whatever. But really, it's about playing hard and going to the net and being physical, finishing your checks. So Don Hay helped me a ton on it. And it was there where I started to develop into that role from a Lady Bing guy in minor hockey.
You go to Kamloops, to be the perfect situation for you, and you win the Memorial Cup, not once, but twice. Like, that is such a phenomenal occurrence, and I don't believe the franchise had ever won before. That must have been, what an experience that must have been for you.
Yeah, it was amazing to win the Memorial Cups and be on teams, with so many guys that would go on to play in the NHL later. But also, my first year going from 16, it was a challenging year. I mean, we won the Memorial Cup, but as a young guy, leaving home, it wasn't easy. It was grade 11. Moving in with Bill families, not my home, but they were, I had some wonderful, kind, generous families. But it was away from home. And also, the hardest part was, a season is 72 games. And in minor hockey, you play every day, you play all the time. I only got to play 48 or 72 regular season games. And so that was really, really challenging. And I'd be sitting out watching games. Even in games that I played, I would get two shifts. There was a competitive team. I would get two shifts in the first period, two shifts in the second period, a shift in the first 10 minutes. This is what a guy, as a year, it was. And then if the game was going really well, I'd get to play maybe another couple shifts if it wasn't going well and it was close. I would maybe get 5 or 6 shifts in a game. So it was a challenge, and it was really cool the way it worked out. And you know, I got better from being around Shane Doan, Darcy Tucker, Ryan Huska, Nolan Baumgartner, all these guys that went on to play in the NHL, Jason Strudwick, Steve Passmore. There were so many of them, and I got to practice with them daily, but it wasn't all just, you know, so easy and fun. And there were times even in my first year where I was like, we'd get off the bus, we'd have a 7-hour bus ride. I'd be sitting up in my, you know, as a rookie, you get one seat. Or that's what we got. We had so many veterans that everybody, if you're a veteran, you get like to lie down, you get 2 seats, you get, you know, you share. We had one seat. I'm saying, you'd go through the mountains and I'd be like swaying back and forth and barely any sleep. And then it would get up and go to school. And we weren't allowed to be late for school. So you get go home and shower. And I remember driving thinking, I don't know if I'm going to make it. Like, this is, you know, but fortunately for the kids now, the WHL, it is easier. The school route, they've changed a little bit, you know, as far as that, but we had tough travel there back then. And so, long story there, but yeah, it was finished awesome. And the playoffs were great. It was fun and it was worth it. And it helped me, but it wasn't all that easy, in my first year.
Doesn't sound so glamorous. Yeah, Jerome. Yeah. So, but 1995, 96, that's your big season. You're the Western Hockey League Player of the Year with 63 goals and 136 points. You played for Canada at the World Juniors. You won a gold medal. You led all players in that tournament with 12 points. You were named the top forward of the tournament. That is pretty impressive stuff. It seems that you always rose to the occasion when you played for Team Canada.
It was always a huge honor. I watched Hockey Canada stuff growing up with my grandpa at Christmas time, World Juniors. And yeah, that year was an amazing, big growth year for me. It was so much fun. Our coach, Ed Dempsey, Don Hay had moved on to the NHL after winning the Memorial Cup at 16-17. So I was 18 that year. And we still had a good team. And Nat Don McKelly, he played in the NHL and he was a line mate. He was a year older. He was an awesome player, had an amazing career over in Switzerland after leaving the NHL. But yeah, so we had a lot of fun. Our coach played us a ton. So it went from 16, not playing much, at 18. He'd be like, yeah, "Can you go again? Can you go again? Can you go again?" So played a lot, but that meant some other poor younger guy wasn't playing as much, but hopefully they got to play a lot when we left. But it was really, really cool. And it was, junior gets a lot, you know, you go from at 16 years old, you're playing against some 20-year-olds, lots of 19-year-olds, 18-year-olds. So it's a big challenge. Guys are stronger and bigger. But as you get older each year, it does get easier. You get bigger and stronger and you're playing against some younger players. So each year in junior got more enjoyable and, you know, had more success and got easier because hopefully, you know, getting better as a player, but also bigger and stronger and got to play against some younger kids. So yeah, junior was a big part of my career, great for growth, and a lot of fun and good memories.
A challenge for you because you're drafted by the Calgary Flames after growing up as an Edmonton Oilers fan. Was that a challenge for you?
No, it wasn't. It was to get to play in the NHL, any of the teams, I would have been thrilled. And then it was cool. You know, I guess it would have been a challenge for my friends and my family. And I worked to convert some and some guys, you know, some of my friends would be like, "Oh, I'm a fan of both." And, I have one uncle who I grew up with. I could never get him to convert. he really pained him. He pained him that I played for Calgary. And if we were playing head to head, he just couldn't, he wouldn't really tell me that, but I could tell deep down he wasn't really cheering for the Flames, you know? So, yeah, it was awesome. It was fun. It was great to be that close to home, have my mom and my dad and my grandparents be able to come down to games, friends. It was really, really neat. But, yeah, it was also, you know, some people ask me, like, Dallas, you know, they were such a good team. You know, would you have wanted to stay there? And, you know, they won the Stanley Cup, but you know, I believe in God and I think things work the way they're supposed to be. But also looking at it, it's Dallas, Neuendijk went there. They won the Stanley Cup, but he was the Conn Smythe Trophy winner. It worked out well for them. He was a big reason why they won the Stanley Cup. So, you know, if I go there and they're an older team, maybe I'm not playing as much as a young guy and getting the same opportunities and getting a chance to develop and be part of their lineup. And breaking in Calgary, I got to play right away. I got to play at 19. I got to be a part of it. I went through some growing pains. I had a really tough second year, or I felt it was really tough. And, you know, maybe if you're on a top team, you don't, you know, they don't let you work through those growing pains and send you to the minors and who knows. So I got lots of great opportunities and great memories was fortunate and blessed to play 16 years in Calgary.
Well, you know, there are those deals that are good for both teams, and that certainly seems like it was perfect for the Flames are going to say, oh, well, wish we hadn't made that trade. Stars aren't going to say that, well, wish we hadn't made that trade, because it worked out so well for both teams. Even though you had the as you mentioned, some issues in the second year, that first year was pretty darn good. Second in the Calder Trophy voting, you had 50 points, which led all first-year players in 96-97. We're in number 24 that first year. Why number 24, and why the change to 12?
Yeah, I got given 12 in Kamloops. It was growing up, I was like 18. I loved 8, 88s, and Kamloops, that was my number. And I just got used to it. And then when I got to the NHL, 12 was taken on Calgary by Paul Cruz. And partway through my first year, Paul Cruz got traded, and number 12 came available. So they asked me if I'd like it. And if you don't jump on it, it's probably going to be, you know, in my mind, 12 looks like a good number, right? So it's going to be gone. But no, so I did take it there about halfway through my year. Glad I did. It just was what I was comfortable to, and I'm sure 24 would have been fine, but no superstition or anything, just what I was used to.
Well, 12 is a very powerful number. It has a lot of significance for me and a lot of my friends, and you were a powerful player, that's for sure. Now, 2001-2002 was your best season. You won the Rocket Richard Trophy with 52 goals. You won the Art Ross Trophy with 96 points. You also won the Ted Lindsay Award as the NHL's top player, selected by the players. I think at the time it was the Pearson Award. Tell us about that season and how 2001, 2002, that's when you're really starting to come into your own, isn't it?
Yeah, I gained a lot of confidence that year. And I think it really started. There was a lot of things that came together that year. But in the summer, getting a chance to get a late invite to Team Canada. Simone Gagné there was a camp in Calgary, and it was where they do the pre-Olympic, and they have, I don't know if it was 50 players or what it was, but I wasn't invited to that initially, and I was fine with that. I mean, in my mind, some of the best players in the world, and I didn't put myself into that levels, and you know, I would have loved to be there, but I was fine with not. And Simone Gagné got hurt after the first day, and he had a groin issue, and I got called, and I came in after the first day. And I always figured, you know, I wondered if I just got a call because they knew I was in Alberta, you know, or was I really that, you know, or was I next? I never really asked, or was I next on the list? Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I just missed. But regardless, I went to that camp, and it was a huge, huge boost for my confidence because I was out there with some of the best players to, you know, Joe Sakic, Yzerman. Were, you know, all around these guys. Eric Lindros was rifling shots, you know, and Brodeur there in net, and you know, it was to be out there on the ice, Korea. And I wasn't like stand, you know, all you did was scrimmage really. And it wasn't that I was like awesome out there, but I was able to like play out there and get some chances and feel like I belonged out there with them. So it was a huge, huge boost to my confidence going into the year. And also at the beginning of the year, that was the first time I started playing with Craig Conroy. We had a great chemistry and things just rolled. And Dean McCammon, we had a really, really good line that year and played most of the year together. And it was just one of those things that just kept building, and everything came together that year. And like I say, chemistry, confidence, and it was one of my most fun years for sure. And first year reaching 50 and getting honored by the players as a Lester B. Pearson Award winner. It was pretty neat. It was something that growing up I dreamed of playing in the NHL. I didn't dream of leading the league in goals, or you know, it was just trying to make the NHL and get better and work at getting better. So it was really a blessed year for sure.
Well, all those opportunities for growth, being around those players and learning that, knowing that you can compete with them. It's kind of like the change I saw in Mario Lemieux after that Canada Cup in 87. He became that, he reached that next level after that. That's what it seemed to me happened for you after 2002, which we're going to talk about more in a minute. But 2003, 2004, you win the Richard Trophy again. And that was a very big year for the Calgary Flames. Now at this point, you become that leader that we all knew about. You guys didn't win the Cup in 2004, but you made the final against Tampa, and really should have won it. You had a shot to win it in Game 6, thanks to you setting up the game winner, against Tampa in Game 5, and then helmetless, no less, and what a great pass that was. And then you almost, you know, you almost single-handedly led the Flames to the Cup that year. And of course, then, and you know, you weren't afraid to mix it up any time in your career. In the playoffs that year, you had to go with Hatcher, Darren Hatcher. You threw bone-crushing checks. You had the scrap with Vinnie LeCavalier, and that was a legendary tilt. You know, we're talking about the Stanley Cup Finals here. You don't see a lot of scraps in the Stanley Cup Finals anymore. But your tilt with Vinny and you know, I mean, you just basically said, guys, hop on my back, we're going for a little ride here, I'm going to do whatever it takes to lead us to the promised land, include to, you know, take care of Le Cavalier. What was that, you know, what, I mean, I'm pretty sure that you're the all-time leader in Gordie Howe hat tricks, probably have more Gordie Howe hat tricks than Gordie Howe had. By Gordie Howe hat tricks, I'm talking about, of course, a goal and assist and a fight in the game, in addition to those bone crunching hits he used to throw. What was that experience like, 2004, despite the, you know, the fact you came up just short, even though that Martin Gélinas goal was definitely in, you know, as we saw in the replay. But you know, as it turns out, you're runner up in the Stanley Cup. And tell us about that run and the city of Calgary at that time and what was going on for you.
It was an amazing run, and it was, you know, I look back and obviously I would wish that goal would have counted and given us, you know, a few minutes to go to win a Stanley Cup. But at the same time, I'm very thankful that I got to go through that experience with the team there in Calgary. It was, you know, we were one goal away from winning, but looking at it, I got to see, and I got to be part of a team that came together, that had so much fun together, that you hear about the winning teams. And you know, I got to do it at different ages and, you know, in Kamloops and stuff. But, you know, watching the NHL and hearing about it and you know, the camaraderie and getting to see it and getting to see different guys be heroes on different nights. And it was really hard not winning it, but it was awesome to go through it. And I think back to each series and the way, you know, we weren't expected. We were underdogs, but mm-hmm. all of our guys, you know, if you go through it, you know, late Steve Monitor, he scored a huge, huge goal against San Jose. What an awesome guy. And he was my roommate for a long time. And, you know, he scored an overtime winner, and he was, you know, he was a D-man. He didn't score a ton of goals. And that was, I remember that one, everyone jumping around. It was an OT winner in San Jose, and we knocked those guys off. They were supposed to beat us. We beat, you know, first of all, before that, we got to Vancouver. They were a huge, huge rival for us, and we beat them in seven, and the series was back and forth, and you know, it was right at the end of the game, we were up, I missed an empty netter, Connie gave me a pass, and I missed the empty netter, they come down, 5 seconds later, there's barely any time left in the game, and they score, they're shorthanded, they go down and score a goal to tie it. It's like all the emotions, but fortunately, we win, Jelly scores in overtime, he had scored three, that would have been four, deciding if that one counted in the finals, four deciding. He scored every series clinching goal that we had, so three, but that would have been four, and I think he would have been the only player I would imagine in history that have done that, probably in any sport. That's like the deciding basket or something in basketball, you know. So it was really, really special that all the different guys that step up, how close we were as a team, how the guys embraced their roles, Daryl coaching, you know, and he does a really good job of making all the players feel important and are important. And some play way more than other guys, but even the guys that play 8 minutes, you know, they buy into the role of it, and it doesn't mean they don't want to play more, but they know they're important. And he does a good job of making guys fit in the roles, but also feel important. And I think as a team, when you're that close, we were a really, really close team. Sean Donovan, I remember, you know, Connie, Jelly, Kipper had an amazing playoffs, and, you know, Regeri, mm-hmm. Rhett Warner. There's so many neat guys that you become friends with and you go through those battles with. But we were one goal, and at least I got to see and feel what it was like to be, you know, on a that type of team, a winning team that could win it all. And like I say, we're one goal from it. So got to do all the experiences, except we didn't get to raise it. And at the end of the day, would have sure loved that. But it was still, as hard as it was not winning, I would go through it again, because there were so many amazing, amazing experiences and ups and downs and so much fun.
Well, you beat the number 3 seed, Vancouver. Then you beat number 2 seed, I think it was LA. And then you beat the number 1 seed, San Jose. I think that's how it went, isn't it?
Detroit. We beat Detroit.
Sorry, Detroit, 2. Second seed.
And
yeah, Detroit was number
we
2.
Had
sorry,
no
Detroit number 2. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I remember in their first game, we beat Vancouver in game 7. And it was so exciting. It was, you know, the overtime. But then we went to Detroit, and it was like 2 days later. It was like, you know, when you play game 7, they start the next series. So we flew to Detroit, and I think we got beat like 5-1 or 5-0. And I remember sitting on the bench in the first, after the first game going, oh, well, you know, like, not oh, well, it's like, at least we made it here, you know, like, and what are our chances? You know, they have Brett Hall, Shanahan, Iserman, you know, the Hatcher, like, Cujo, and they were just loaded. And, you know, Matthew Schneider, all these guys, and somehow we, you know, well, I shouldn't say somehow, Kipper absolutely stood on his head and played unbelievable. In that whole series, we'd win games like 1-0, 2-1. And we won it in 6, and it was shocking. It was really, really cool. And it was, I wouldn't want to play him again. At that time, I don't know if we'd win another series against them the next time, but that one series, Kipper was just amazing.
Right. And that's where you had that great scrap with Hatcher too. I mean, that was, you know, that was a spark. That was the TSN turning point, if you will, I think, of that series, when you, you know, decided you're going to take on Hatcher, and that worked out pretty well for you guys. So you come up short against, you know, against Tampa, even though you probably won that game. But anyway, you had a lot of, you know, you followed that up with a gold medal performance of the Canada Cup, and you had a lot of career milestones, including, you know, fortunately with the Flames still, you got your 500th goal. It came January 7th, 2012, against the Minnesota Wild. And it's your 500th goal, all with the same team. Not a lot of players can say that. Tell us about that goal.
Oh, I see the highlight. It was an ugly goal, hey? Just throwing it to the net. It went off of there, skating in. It was cool that it got to be in Calgary and got to be at home. But highlight-wise, I wish it was a little nicer. I was being a little bit spoiled, hey? I show my kids... I'm very, very, you know, very blessed to get to 602, and it's literally just as ugly. They're both off of somebody else's skating in, and, you know, it's like they don't think I scored any nice goals, you know.
Right.
But
let's roll that one, Vic. Roll the number 602. Roll the number 602. So this is against now you're playing with Pittsburgh. You go Pittsburgh, Boston, and Colorado, and that's where you got your 600th goal. Vic, if we can find number 600, you know, this is, again, you talked about what kind of goal it was. You had a lot of great goals, Iggy, breakaway goals, shootout winners, you know, phenomenal goals, tic-tac-toe passing plays, you know, all that kind of stuff. But it just so happened that those two milestone goals, number 500 and number 600, just happened to be, not quite the kind of goals we were talking about. Number 600 was, you know, it was a centering pass. It went off the skate of Jake Muzzin, We just looked at that the other day. And that's goal number 600. Not the prettiest, but as they say, a goal is a goal is a goal. And I think, you know, that means, hey, goals are like kids. You love them all the same, right?
But that's the thing. As much as I'm making fun of it, I'll tell you, I was happy to get all of them and take them all. And here's the one you're showing. I try to pass it to the front. I don't even know. Oh, maybe I'm going back door to Duchesne or something. And it goes in off of Muzzin right. skating it and 600. But yeah, that was a huge thrill for sure. And I never dreamt growing up I would get 500 goals in the NHL, 600 goals. When I first started and you start to do the math, it took me a while to get to 30. And my first 30 goal season, I think it was in my fourth year. And, you know, you start to, I've never dreamed, you know, if you would try to do that 20 times, you know what I mean? So it was just, yeah, I was very blessed to play with a lot of great passers, people that set me up and, you know, back doors from Tanguay, Alex Tanguay to Craig Conroy. I loved playing with Camilleri. You know, there's different guys over the time. Theo Fleury, I got to break in and play with him early in my first few years, learned a lot from him about goal scoring. So yeah, it was fun. But like you say, Joe, as much as I make fun of it, I loved all the goals. I didn't care if it went off my butt, whatever it was, you go to the net off my arm, I'll take them all and happy all this, you know, all the same. But now when I show my kids, the only thing is when I show the kids the highlights and they see the 500, 600, they're like, well, you weren't very skilled, Dad, you know? So and it's not the same. It's grainy and be like, look at this 1996 goal, you know what I mean? So way back. So it is what it is. And, you know, they probably wouldn't listen to me anyway as far as the skill. So.
Well, if your kids are watching, trust me, guys. Your dad had a lot of really nice goals. and you know what? And I'll tell you something else. He got to those dirty areas so he could get the ugly goals too, right? So, yeah, you had stops in Pittsburgh, Boston, Colorado, and L.A. But you left the Flames, and that couldn't have been easy for you because, I mean, that was your team. You were the guy. You were the captain. 8.5 years you were captain of the Flames, and you were the team leader. You were the man in Calgary. That couldn't have been easy to leave, but, you know, but the Flames were rebuilding, and it was a deal they decided it was best for the team, right?
Yeah, no, it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy at all leaving. I was, you know, it was for a number of reasons. Firstly, that leaving, it was, you know, the goal was to try to win a Stanley Cup in Calgary and really wanted to do that and amazing fans. And, you know, the red mile started during the 04 run and the sea of red and just dying to get that back. And unfortunately, it didn't happen. And so that was hard to shut that chapter and know that, you know, as a athlete, you're always, it's important to be positive and you're always thinking how you can, you know, next, okay, how can I work towards the next thing? And, you know, tomorrow's going to be better and, you know, next game and next season. And now that dream was done. And so now it was about trying to follow, trying to win a Stanley Cup. And yes, they were rebuilding. It was good for Calgary to get some assets and draft picks or whatever they chose to do, but, you know, draft picks and prospects at that time. But also for me, it was, you know, I look back at, you know, I was comfortable. I was, my family, you know, we had kids there, we grew up there. I'd been there since 19. So now I was 36. So it was a long time it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy deciding to, but it was the right thing to do for me because, as you know, a goal was to try to win a Stanley Cup. That's what I was playing for. And I look back and I get asked, you know, would you do it again? Was it the right thing or would you just stay? And I'm happy I left. I'm happy I tried. You know, it didn't work out. I didn't win a Stanley Cup, but had many amazing experiences after that. And, you know, I had went to Pittsburgh and had to learn how to, you know, I was a new guy in the locker room and trying to fit in and try to help them win. And it was great until we ran into Boston in the semifinals. And it was a tough series and we lost a lot of close games and all of a sudden we got swept. So that one hurt. But the next year getting to go to Boston, it was very, very happy they gave me opportunity to go there the next year. And it was a great year. We won the President's Trophy, and it was the first time I'd been around it. The President's Trophy is the the best regular season record for a hockey team. So it was the first time I'd been around a team that in Calgary, it was always like we were always in the mix of the playoffs. Every game was so important. It was do or die. And it was, you're always like, it's all, even the regular season, there's a lot of pressure on each game and stress. And in Boston, we were a very, very good team. Those guys were used to winning, and we were strong. And so it wasn't that same pressure, and it wasn't Canada. It was a different vibe. And as far as the daily, you know, the pressures go. So it was kind of fun. It was very fun. And the team expected to win games. We were good. You go into it. And unfortunately that year we lost in the playoffs to Montreal. Price stood on his head. We lost in seven games in the second series. So, and that was one of the only teams that gave us trouble all year. You know, who knows what else would have happened, but Montreal was just one of those things that year. And I think that they in Boston, they have so much history. They still go at it, but that was one of the teams that year. So, and even going to Colorado, my family and I got to play with McKinnon and Landeskog and see them as young guys, and Rantanen and just coming into the league, and Duchesne, and got to be there with those guys while they were young, and watch them grow a little bit over the 3 years I was there. And it was a great place to live, and we really enjoyed it. So all in all, it was an amazing journey. I'm happy it got to experience these things. My family really enjoyed it. It was, it's been, hockey's been awesome, and would have loved to win a Stanley Cup, but I feel so blessed to have gotten to experience all the different things I got to do, and cities and places I got to see, and people I got to play with.
Well, the Flames and the fans never forgot about you, that's for sure. And of course, they had a ceremony to retire your jersey March 2nd, 2019. Tell us about that. What was that like to watch your number 12 raised to the rafters with the fans chanting Iggy? And, you know, you're the all-time leader in goals, points, games played. What was that?
No, that was very humbling. It was really an amazing honor, and to have my family there, my mom, my dad, there's a sea of red, to have my kids there, and the Flames, they treated our kids so well. They took our boys on the ice for pregame skate with them, and Goudreau and Tkachuk, and they got pictures with them. They got to be part of their pregame skate. It was an amazing, amazing experience, and always great to go back to Calgary and see friends there. And there's so many people on the staff that are still there, and Peter Hanlon, and who's vice president there, head of PR, the training staff, Depot. It was really, really cool, but it was also a little bit sad. It was like, it's the end of it was so much fun playing and being a professional athlete, and so many great memories there. And I hadn't been on the ice much, so it was awesome, but it was a little bit sad. And it was being a professional hockey player is an amazing, amazing job. And it's not one that's, you know, you hear a lot of people retire and they're excited to retire, and you don't hear a lot of pro athletes that are excited to retire, you know, it was time for me to retire. But I love playing. I loved it, and it was so much fun. And I was happy to spend the time with my family and my kids and be at home and everything. But it wasn't like I missed hockey. I missed the professional game, the competing, the cities you get to see, and just how much fun all of that is. But I was really thankful to get to be home with my kids and spend time with them while they're young, and that's gone fast too. So so a lot of mixed emotions in that one for sure, but what an honor, and I'm really, really thankful that they gave me that honor.
It was a beautiful ceremony. I just watched it again recently. It was amazing. So there's no Stanley Cup, but you got two Memorial Cups, World Junior, World Championship, World Cup, a pair of Olympic gold medals. Okay, so 2002, we didn't get a chance to talk about that yet, but you scored two goals in the gold medal game to win the championship. And of course, the golden goal in 2010, getting a chance to play on Canadian soil, the Vancouver Games, getting a chance to play with Sid. And I know Vic, our producer, want to ask me this. Did you hear Sid calling for the puck?
Absolutely, absolutely. Make sure, guys, young kids, make sure you talk on the ice. Talk, talk, talk. It makes the game easier. If he's not yelling for this, there's no way I even try to throw it to him. But he was yelling with a and with an urgency, like you knew he got by the guy. So I really wanted to try to get it to him. And obviously, he his quick hands and his quick release, what a great shot, big goal. But truly, that was so much fun. There was in the dressing room when they came back and tied it, U.S. tied it on us late. It was like so nerve-wracking getting ready to go into the overtime because, you know, you're an athlete, but also a fan. And you know, going out there, it's going to be something we're going to remember forever or hear about forever. So it could either be really, really positive or not. But, you know, as an athlete, you sign up for those things. And it is, you know, I always believe the more things on the line, the more fun it is to play. And especially when it goes well. And that was like, felt like it was a peewee memory, you know, like our dream from peewee, you getting to throw our gloves around Sid, you know, like being on home soil, the fans and the electricity. It was so cool. And what a neat moment. And very, very blessed. Yeah, it was fun and great to see all the time. Every time I see a highlight of it, it's always going to make me smile. It was neat.
Well, you did it from your knockout on the play, and you still managed to get the goal to Sid. And how determined were you guys? Because like you said, like 24 ticks left, the Americans scored to tie it, and now they've got all the momentum, and now you're going overtime and such. I mean, the whole freaking world is watching this game, certainly North America and certainly Canada. Did you feel some pressure there?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, we felt pressure. It was... And they beat us in the round robin too. And it was, you know, when you're playing that game and you're up with a goal left with a few minutes, you're up a goal with a few minutes left in a game. You're trying to keep playing, but you're also like, you're watching the clock. You're trying not to, but each minute matters. Each minute. Now you're under a minute, and it's a tight game. And we have some of the best defenders in the world. You know, it's. You know, it's we're that close. So when they score, it stings. You're that close to a gold medal on home soil. We go into the locker room. It's quiet. There's, you know, for the first 5 minutes in there, there's not a lot of talking. And you know, it's like, man, we were that close and we let it slip away. You know, or get out of, you know. So, but then I think it was Niedermeyer, and I think he said, Scott Niedermeyer, he was our captain. I think he said someone's going to be a hero tonight, and then we start getting each other going. And then Mike Babcock, he was a good leader, and he came in as a coach and got us refocused. And now we're recharged. Now we focus not on what ifs or what, you know, the bad side if we don't win or anything like that. You try to just put all your focus into what do we need to do. Let's be positive. Let's go work. Let's go have some fun. We're in the overtime. Someone's going to be a hero tonight. And fortunately. It did work out that way, and Sid got that big goal. But yeah, lots of nerves. It's funny because when you're on in those type of games, when you're on the bench, you're a fan. You're like watching. You're excited. You're like a little bit nervous. And then when you go on the ice, you just go, go, go. You just work away and compete and play. And it's easier to be playing in those situations than being on the bench as a fan and being nervous or not getting much in the game. So yeah, it was really, really cool and a neat experience about all those sport things you hear about staying positive, about focusing and staying in the moment. It was one of those that, you know, was for the rest of our careers, I'm sure we all got to draw on and learn from firsthand.
You know, I can remember just like it was yesterday. It was so exciting and so much fun. And I was just, everybody was just on their feet going, yeah, unbelievable, hugging. And we're just watching on TV, you know, I can just imagine what it was like being there. Now, I was fortunate enough to be there last November when you're inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame, and Mark Messier doing the honors, no doubt, no less. Right. And of course, yes, you won the Mark Messier Award as well. I forgot to mention that. How cool was it to have Mess give you your plaque and do the induction?
Oh, it was really, really cool. It was very, very surreal, the whole experience. Mark Messier grew up in St. Albert. It was something that being a young St. Albertan, growing up there too, we all knew about Mark Messier. We followed his career. I followed it growing up. He was one of my favorite players. He was one of the first power forwards that I looked up to, played with heart, determination, had skill, won. What a great leader. And then being from St. Albert, even more so. So yeah, it was a really, really cool moment, but also very surreal. Like he's handing, you know, what an honor for me that he's handing me the plaque at the Hall of Fame, and I'm in the Hall of Fame because it's to see past players there, to have my wife there, Kara, kids, her parents, my parents. And it was, you know, life goes so fast, as you know, and as you get older, it goes quicker and quicker. And when you're a kid, you think, oh, it doesn't go that fast. But man, it's gone so fast, and my career went so quick. And, you know, I got to be in the Hall of Fame, and Mark Messier is handing. It was like, it was really, really neat. It was something that I didn't expect growing up. I dreamed of playing in the NHL. I dreamed of, you make it, you want to just stay in the NHL. It's an amazing league. It's fun. People are always trying to get in and working away. And each year there's turnover. People are leaving the league. Other guys are breaking in. So you just work away to keep trying to get better. And then you, once you establish yourself and you're in, you want to work to try to now it's all about focusing to do everything you can to try to win. And, you know, and you always want to win. That's part of being a competitor. But firstly, you want to be on the team, you know, you want to be a part of it. Right. So that's where your focus is. It's how you can find a role within the team. And then it's all about focusing, growing to be a better player, to help your team win and all that. And before you know it, career's over. 20 years went by and what happened? And it was just a blink of an eye and got to be in the Hall of Fame. So yeah, I've been truly, truly blessed. And hockey's been really, really good to me. I've made a lot of great friends, great memories. And got to experience things I never even, better than I even dreamed. So it's, like you say, I got to win Memorial Cups and got to be a part of Team Canada. And growing up, I got to win provincials, all these things. I didn't get to win the Stanley Cup at the end, but, you know, I got to play 20 years and have an amazing, so many neat experiences and stuff. So no complaints and just thrilled that I got to be as blessed as I was and got to play as long as I did.
Well, two of the greatest leaders never mind in the NHL, all sports, incredible captains, both from St. Albert. What are the odds of that? But we do have some of the speech from the Hall of Fame induction, which I want to just play for you now. Vic, can we roll up?
It's important for me tonight to thank Hall of Famer Grant Fuhr. Grant was one of my idols growing up in St. Albert, just outside Edmonton, and I was thrilled to play with him in Calgary at the end of his career. I also want to acknowledge Grant and the recent inductee, the amazing Will Rhee, and guys like Claude Vilgrain and Tony McKegney and Herb Carnegie for breaking racial barriers in hockey. Being a young black hockey player, it was important for me to see other black players in the NHL. In my first year of hockey as a 7-year-old, a kid came up to me and said, "Why are you playing hockey?" Over the years, I would hear, "What are your chances of playing in the NHL? There's not many black players." I hear other stuff. Luckily, there was only a few. And I know it's thanks to guys like Grant and Willie who made me know that my dream of playing in the NHL was attainable. To Kara, Jade, Tej, and Joe, to retire from what I believe is the greatest job in the world isn't easy. But having you guys to spend time with, to be a family, to coach, not you, Kara, you usually coach us, but I wouldn't trade it for anything. I dreamt, this is all, like I say, a little harder to believe. I dreamt and imagined how great it would be, the cities and countries I would see, the arenas, the players. I want to thank God for all his blessings. It's been even better than I ever dreamt. Thank you again for this incredible honor. Thank you.
Well, that was pretty amazing. You know, you talked about your family, and I just want to touch on it for a second. Your daughter Jade was invited to try out for the girls, Canadian girls under 18s. Tej was drafted ninth overall in the WHA by the Seattle Thunderbirds. How good are your kids going to be? And Joe. Joe, of course, right?
Yeah, and Joe, I'm coaching here at the Academy. His draft year is next year into the WHL. Yeah, so no, it's been really it's gone fast. It's been awesome to be home and get to spend time with them, and we've, you know, that they've liked hockey has been a real treat for myself. It's been nice to share it with them. And yeah, Jade made the Team Canada under 18 team, and she, you know, was really, really disappointed in I think it was January or February where it got canceled. I think it was February for the World Championship. She was looking forward to be a part of it, but it did get rescheduled into June here, the women's. So we're waiting to hear where it is, but it's in June. So that's, she's really pumped. We're all really pumped for her to get a chance to represent Canada on that U18 team. And then Tej, yeah, he just got drafted. He's to Seattle. So that's very exciting. A new chapter. You know, he's hoping to be out of the house next year and be living there at 16. So that all restarts. And like I say, he is uh-huh. luckier than I was, because now they do the schooling either online or they get it done in half a day. They don't have to have the same travel. And Seattle's, you know, different travel schedule, different school schedule than when I was younger at 16. So you'd see, it's going to be hopefully a little bit easier that wise, but it's going to be fun watching him. And I'm happy that he's following his dream. And it's been awesome to try to share stuff with them. And then Joe, I'm coaching now at Rink Academy Kelowna, and it's been a ton of fun. I coach him. He's 13. It's a team full of 13 and 14 year olds, and they're a good team. It's great to work with them. And like I say, you're going through stuff. It's like, I'm also a little bit camp counselor, you know, as far as helping them understand, you know, as you're trying to help them be better hockey players, but also better teammates, and try to, you know, learn and grow in the game and off the ice, and how you treat each other, how you'd like to be treated, make sure everyone's included and feels good. And the better teammates you can be, the better team you become, and more just better person you can be. So, so it's been a lot of fun, and I'm enjoying it. It's been a real blessing to get to share sports with them and share hockey. And they don't always listen, or sometimes I don't think they're listening. Then I'll see them working on something that, you know, I'll see Joe working on something we talked about, but he didn't give me any acknowledgement that he was even listening. But so that's rewarding. But it's been awesome. Hopefully they get they are enjoying the hockey, but hopefully they'll continue to play a long time. Their dream is to be pro hockey players for the boys. And Jade's going to college next year at Brown. So I'm excited for her to do that and watch her play there and enjoy the game. So hockey is, it's been a great avenue, but also, you know, friendships and learning and growing. I love sports and for the experiences, but also for the friendships and learning the camaraderie and all that stuff. So that goes with it. So it's great that our kids are involved. And Kara's been driving around and working, and she's going to get a break hopefully next year a little bit. Hopefully two of them are going to be out of the house. And in a way, hopefully, I know we'll miss them, but they'll be following their dreams. So then she'll get a little bit of a break from some of the stuff, all the cooking and the driving and the planning and all the stuff that she's a big part of.
I'm going to enjoy that time together, I'm sure. And what I'm hearing is Tej probably won't be standing on a bus, holding onto the rail, swaying his way through the mountains like his dad did.
That's right. And it was. I remember exactly, you know, going up there. I'm sure he will be the first year. I'll bet you that doesn't change as far as rookies only get one seat and not two and all that stuff. But they have a little bit different travel schedule. And if they are online in school, he can probably not have to get up at our 2 hours of sleep or whatever back then, or 3 hours. But it was good. It made me tougher. It was strong. And I'm sure he'll have his own, rookie's a rookie, I guess, eh?
Yeah. Yeah, not as bad as he used to be, though. That's pretty good. You talked about, you know, Willie O'Ree, and you touched on Grant Fuhr in your speech, your induction speech. Has the NHL improved the area of inclusion and diversity?
Well, I think it's improved. I came in at a time in the NHL at a good time where there was more focus on diversity, and when I first got into the NHL, there was we had to do there was diversity program. I'm losing the word right now what it was. It was awareness for the nationalities and but what was acceptable. So we had to go to meetings as players. You know, each team every year had to. I'm sorry, I'm forgetting what the actual meetings were called, but you'd go in as players and learn what was not acceptable and as far as like different nationalities and racism and make, you know, in inclusion and being accepting, but also, you know, sometimes players would just throw out, you know, derogatory statements or names or whatever, and mm-hmm. not even understanding, you know, but it was, the NHL did a good job of, when I first broke in, I was lucky that it came in a time where they were starting to put a focus on it, where it wasn't going to be acceptable. And my time in the NHL, I didn't have many stories. My teammates treated me very well, and I know that guys before me didn't have as easy as I had it, and had more issues. And even still, in places, there's issues that kids shouldn't have to deal with, and there should, you know, racism and there's still room for improvement, and they're still working away at it. But it's a great game, and also a locker room of a hockey locker room is made up of so many different nationalities from around the world, and it's part of what makes it special. It is. You know, I can think of the mm-hmm. Swedish players mm-hmm. I played with, and Finnish players, and Kipper, and you know, the different the jokes and the humor, and you know, it's being able to embrace that, and it's not a bad thing, it's a great thing, and to be able to embrace that we're from different places and different cultures, and that's what makes a hockey locker room so special. And it's like 25 people plus the training staff plus the coaches, there's definitely keep going, and the game is for everybody, and find ways to make it more accessible for everybody is important. I know that Will Ree had it so much tougher than I did. And I know that because mm-hmm. of him and other guys, Mike Marson and guys that came after, I had a much easier route, and I'm very thankful for that.
Yeah, and it's we had Kwame Mason last, and he talked about how this is on all of us to do what we can to, you know, to make this better. Like, instead of pointing fingers and talking about other people are doing and people aren't doing enough, but the NHL does have that diversity department now, and it always comes down to what can I do. You know, we're all God's kids. We all got to get along. We all got to make, you know, see each other as God's kids, and you know what. What can I do to make it better? That's always what it comes down to. Well, Jerome, I just want to touch quickly. You did an amazing asset that you've done in Crick, with juvenile diabetes and a kid sports. Kid sport was big for you, and you're personally responsible for some $900,000 being raised for kid sport. You won the King Clancy Award for your contributions to the community. Why was the community so important for you?
Oh, I think that going to Calgary and being part of the Flames, I think that the ownership did a great job of setting an example and helping us be involved in the community. Peter Hanlon, who's been a long time there, he's vice president there, head of PR there, and trying to align us with players. You know, the owners give a ton back. Like, over the years, Mr. Hotchkiss, the Seaman brothers, and you see their stories of all their generosity in the community and stuff, and they were great examples. It's continued. I know the Flames are a big part of the community there and giving back. And so when we go as players, I always thought, and I said Peter and stuff, they would help align us with causes that meant something to us, that were extra special to us. And so for myself, sports was a big part of my life. And like I said, way back, my mom thought that helped keep me out of trouble. I had energy to burn, and I just wanted to play and play and play. And I played all year, all the time, multiple sports. And I was fortunate that my grandparents were there to help out and with driving and costs at certain times. So not everybody has that, but So sports meant a lot to me, and being able to have the life that I've lived and the memories and the friendships. And so kids sport was a natural for me. And I think it's a great program, and helping kids just be involved, not just hockey, but whatever sport that they can help the cause, and help kids have fun and burn that energy and make friends and learn different life lessons. And so that was really special to me and meant a lot and was easy to get involved with and a great program. And so I think that the Flames should get a lot of credit for their, you know, for being an example in the community and helping the players align with things that are personal.
Well, Jerome, we'll see another Jerome Iginla as a result of your efforts. One of the great power forwards of all time. It's been an absolute pleasure having you on the show. Maybe the greatest power forward of all time. I can say that. Maybe the greatest, the greatest Calgary Flame. I'm going to go out on that limb and say that. Like I said, Jerome, it's been such a pleasure for me to have you on the show. Always been a huge fan. And you're just an outstanding human being on and off the ice. As Craig Button, your former GM, once said, as good a player as Jerome Iginla is, he's an even better person in real life, a better person off the ice. And there you go, right there. Better person than a player. And we all know. Thanks for that, Vic. Our producer, Vic, is on the ball. Thank you, sir. And for being a guest on Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show, we've got some great Italian threads for you from Classic Imports. Next time you're in Eastern Canada, let me know. We'll go play some golf, and we'll get you hooked up with Jeff for some great Italian threads. Thanks, Jerome.
Hey, thanks, Joe. I enjoyed it. Thanks for having me.
All right, buddy. And we'll have more sports when we come back.
Guests on Joe Tilley Sports receive a gift certificate from Classica Imports. Top of the line imported men's clothing. Check out the Classica Essential Collection now. Go to shopclassica.com.
Hey, this is Tommy Graisley, a.k.a. Tommy Gunn. I love two things, music and sports. And when I want sports, I go to the Joe Tilley Show. He gives me everything I want. It's a great show. Check it out for yourself. Joe Tilley Sports, coming up.
Good night.
When I'm working out, I like to wear my Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show t-shirt. It makes me feel handsome and strong. If you want a t-shirt, support the show, click on the link below. Now, back to my workout.
1,761, 1,762, 1,763, 1,764.
Addiction Rehab Toronto, Toronto's number one alcohol and drug treatment center, saving lives, reuniting families. The only treatment center in the province to offer medical detox, treatment, sober living, and lifetime aftercare all in one place. Our unique and specialized programs are designed to equip our clients with the tools to successfully lead a life of dignity, respect, and purpose. Let us help save your life or your loved one's life. Call today for more information or to facilitate an intervention. 1-855-787-2424 or visit addictionrehabtoronto.ca.
Joe Tilley Sports is brought to you by COSA, Central Ontario Standardbred Association, providing a united voice for harness horse people racing at Ontario tracks. Check out your benefits today at COSAonline.com and check out COSA TV on Facebook and YouTube for all the latest harness news and live action updates. Live racing year-round. Go to hpibet.com for all your wagering options. Become a member today, and your first bet is free. That's hpibet.com.
Slow play. It's a slippery slope. First you go looking for that lost ball, and then everything goes sideways. There are a lot of golfers on the course. Make certain of your point of entry. Look quickly and move on. Remember, we're here for a good time, not a long time.
Find anything, Bob?
Not yet.
Shop clublink.ca for golf equipment, demo clubs, trade-ins, golf apparel, men's and women's, custom fittings, accessories, all at your fingertips. Shop clublink.ca.
Moment. Sixth outside control.
Yes, and now
ball.
My Kosa Swiss Doc's pick of the week. Last week I went to Mohawk for the second leg of the Ontario Girls Pacing Series. I decided to go with the long shot. Share the moment. The number three horse didn't get a particularly good trip. Travis Cullen opted not to take her outside. Might not have made any difference anyway. Awesome Hill, the favorite, was the best horse in this night. Just Daisy made a late rally to finish second. Share the moment was fourth. This week, Thursday night, it's a $42,000 final of the Girls Pacing Series. This time, I'm looking at another horse with a price. Number three, Village Jade, with Chris Christopheru in the buggy. Came close last week. I think she might just pull it off and throw Awesome Hill and Just Daisy into the 1-3-5 exacta. Reminder, all the racing updates, visit COSA TV on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. Go to hbibet.com for your wagering options. Time now for the RICOM Wrap, sports news that's close to home. Well, they're not looking much like a legitimate Stanley Cup contender, at least not these days. But the Leafs, you know, they got spanked by the Sabres. They blew a third period lead against the Canucks. Both home dates, I have to say, I expected better. But they did manage to hang on for the win in Columbus. But they let a 3-0 lead slip away, and you can't win come playoff time without top-notch goaltending and defense. The Buds are not getting it done right now. But there's time to get this turned around. Congratulations also to Wayne Simmonds on reaching the 1,000-game mark. It's been a tough go for the Rap attack, and yes, as well. They've dropped 6 of their last 8 games, the only win coming against the depleted Nets side. They've certainly missed Freddie, still out with that knee issue. Malachi Flynn also missed that game against the Cavaliers. It's not that big of a deal standings-wise, but you'd like to be playing your best hoops as you head down the stretch. And a rough go for another Toronto club, Toronto FC, with the New York Red Bulls in town. The Reds had no answer for Lewis Morgan. Morgan scored 3 times to lead the Red Bulls to a 4-1 romp. Jesus Jimenez scored the lone goal for TFC, who head to Columbus next weekend. The Toronto Rock were looking for a little payback, and by golly, they got it. 1 week after a 14-13 setback to the last place New York Riptide, the Rock took advantage of some home cooking in the return match at First Ontario Center. Close to 8,000 fans. Yes, they had fans in the house, and they liked what they saw. Dan Dawson had an amazing night playing in his 306th NLL game, which tied a league record. The 40-year-old scored twice, set up 4 others to pace the Rock to a 12-9 victory. They are now 7-4 on the year and will be in Vancouver on Saturday night. Wow, those Canadian tennis players continue to rack up those Ws. Leila Annie Fernandez successfully defended her title at the Monterrey Open in Mexico. The 19-year-old from Laval struggled with her first serve, but still got it done over Colombia's Camila Osorio in 3 sets, her second WTA Tour title. Meanwhile, Canada's Rebecca Morillo captured an ITF Pro Circuit title in Arcadia, California on the weekend. Okay, let's see how I made out on the par 3 6th at El Tigre this week.
Okay, we're at the 9th hole here in El Tigre, and I want you to say hello to my little friend. Isn't he a beauty?
God damn it.
4! Yes.
It's on. It's at the pin. A little to the right. And
what a shot. Joe Tilley. What a shot.
It's a little long. It's a little long, but I'm on the green, baby.
Today's environmental tip: use fewer plastic bags. Plastic bags are made from fossil fuels, and that has a negative impact on the climate. Drains clogged with plastic waste can contribute to major flooding. Plastic bags harm wildlife in numerous ways. They may ingest the plastic, or animals can get tangled in discarded plastic.
RICOM, passionate people who turn complicated business problems into simplified technology solutions. For public and private sector real estate, properties, portfolios, and enterprise customers, optimize and future-proof smart buildings from the ground up. Smart Tech Solutions, the latest in fault locating, base building network design, managed services, cybersecurity, data analytics. Our fault detection will support all smart strategies, define projected outcomes for capital planning, and reduce environmental impact. RICOM, smart protection solutions. At RICOM, we're building a path to a smart and environmentally friendly future and a carbon-free economy.
And we want to thank all the folks who make this show possible. These are friends, trusted business associates, and all-around great folks. And we thank you all. I highly recommend each and every one of them. A reminder that this show is now available on Spotify, iTunes, Breaker, Radio Public, Google Podcasts, and Pocket Cast, as well as the Spanglish Network and Zingo TV. Also, please like and subscribe to the show on YouTube. Check out all the former episodes. It's free and it's fun. Thank you once again to Jarome Iginla for being on the show. It was an absolute pleasure to have him on. Thank you for watching, and join us next week when Canadian football legend Frank Cosentino drops by. We'll see you then. Joe Tilley's Great Canadian Sports Show is brought to you by
Brian Gribben Insurance Planning, helping you solidify your financial future.
At BGIP, what we do that's unique in the marketplace is we show people how to spend and enjoy their money in their early years of retirement without the fear of running out. Also, we're able to do this without you having to change financial advisors. Please look us up at bgip.ca today. Let's book a 30-minute phone call to see how we can bring value to you and your family in your planning.
Call Brian today for all your retirement needs. We did. 905-686-5678.
Do you want to buy or sell a home? Could 31 years of real estate experience help you? Why not speak to an amazing team that loves to overpromise and overdeliver? Aldo has a tremendous team of experts on staff. They are committed to making your next real estate transaction smooth and comfortable. Call 416-GET-ALDO or visit getaldo.com.
Brought to you by MNP, a leading Canadian national accounting, tax, and business consulting firm. MNP proudly serves and responds to the needs of our clients in the private, public, and non-for-profit sectors. Through partner-led engagements, MNP provides a collaborative, cost-effective approach to doing business and personalized strategies to help people and organizations succeed across the country and around the world. With local offices in Oshawa, Toronto, Mississauga, Burlington, and more, our team is here to support you. Visit mnp.ca to learn more.